Well, I want to welcome you back to our midweek Bible study. I'm Brother Bill, pastor at Mount Pisgah Baptist Church, and we're glad to have you as part of this Bible study. Our study today is going to be in Psalm chapter 39. Have you ever had a parent, maybe as a grown-up, have your boss tell you to pay attention to what you're doing? It really does pay attention. It really pays to pay attention to whatever it is you're doing. We have multitudes of crazy drivers around here that just do not stop. They don't yield the right of way when they're supposed to. They don't use their turn signal. Failing to do these things could cause a wreck. And to me, it's a matter of not paying attention to your driving habits. We have a big push right now, have been for a while, that no texting while driving, because it's a distraction. It pays to pay attention while you're driving. Driving's not a time for texting. It's not a time to shave either or to put on your makeup. I have a cousin who likes to turn around completely as he's driving and talk to the people in the back seat. Very nerve-wracking. So there's a time for everything, and everything is to be done in its time, but not while you're driving. Don't be distracted. I understand that a person who texts, if they just look down at their phone for 5 seconds, and you're going 55 miles an hour, by the time you look back up after just 5 seconds, you've already traveled the length of a football field. It pays attention. It pays to pay attention to everything we do in life. We need to pay attention in our marriage, in our family, pay attention at work, pay attention in our relationships. I met a man, a fine, godly man in Katy's. He'd come to the restaurant that I own there, and he just had one arm. A great friend of mine, even to this day, we call each other. Well, one day I asked him what happened to his arm, and he told me that when he was a teenager, he was clearing the corn out of the harvester. I guess those things get hung up. And it was something he had done hundreds of times, but as he put it to me, as he explained the story to me, this one time he failed to pay attention. And that machine caught his hand, and it pulled his arm right off. So again, I say it pays to pay attention. We need to watch our lives to make sure we do right, to live right. We need to watch our lives so that we can please the Lord. And there's only one way that we can do that, and that is to go by the word of God. The psalmist said in Psalm 119, verse 11, "Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I may not sin against thee." And in verse 9, he says, "How can a young man keep his way pure? By living according to your word." In our Psalm chapter 39, the psalmist gives us a list of what we are to pay attention to watch as we go through this life. So let me read this 39th Psalm for you. And we pray that God would bless the reading and the hearing of his word. Psalm 39, verse 1 says, "I said, I will take heed to my way, that I sin not with my tongue. I will keep my mouth with a bridle while the wicked is before me. I was dumb with silence. I held my peace, even from good, and my sorrow was stirred. My heart was hot within me. While I was musing, the fire burned." In other words, while I was thinking, "then spake I with my tongue, Lord, make me to know mine end and the measure of my days, what it is, that I may know how frail I am. Behold, thou hast made my days as a handbreadth, and mine age is nothing before thee. Verily, every man at his best state is altogether vanity." Selah. Verse 6, "Surely every man walketh in a vain show. Surely they are disquieted in vain. He heapeth up riches and knoweth not who shall gather them. And now, Lord, what wait I for? My hope is in thee. In the first verses, we have the first thing that we are to watch, the first thing we're to pay attention to, and God tells us to watch your mouth. The commitment that he made is, Lord, I will watch my mouth. In another version, our text says, I will watch my ways and keep my tongue from sin. And he says, I will put a muzzle on my mouth as long as the wicked are in my presence. Did you know that the tongue is a very dangerous tool? In the New Testament, James in chapter 3, verse 6 says this about the tongue. He says, the tongue is a fire. It's a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members. It defileth the whole body. It setteth on fire the course of nature, and it is set on the fire of hell. Another version of another verse in Psalm chapter 5, verse 9, it says, not a word from their mouth can be trusted. Their heart is filled with destruction. Their throat is an empty grave. With their tongue, they speak deceit. Psalm 10:7 says, his mouth is full of curses and lies and threats. Trouble and evil are under his tongue. Psalm 17, verse 10, they close up their callous hearts and their mouth speaks with arrogance. The word of God is filled with things, verses that tell us how wicked our speech, our tongue, our words can be. And a mouth that speaks deceit or curses or lies, threats, or even just arrogant, I'm not sure a mouth could get worse than what we've just read about. R.G. Letourneau, who was an outstanding Christian businessman a generation ago, he headed a company that manufactured large earth-moving equipment. And he once remarked he used to make a scraper known as the Model G. Somebody asked him, what does the G stand for? And that man was pretty quick on the trigger. He says, I'll tell you, the G stands for gossip, because like a tale bearer, this machine moves a lot of dirt and moves it fast. Beloved, we need to be careful with the words that we say. Gossip is a big fault that many people have. Some people just can't help it. It's such an ingrained part of their lives. And they often justify it. Jesus said in Matthew 12:34, you brood of vipers, how can you who are evil say anything good? And out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. So Jesus tells us right there where the words come from. They didn't slip out. These are things that were in the heart. Our speaking is a matter of the heart. Out of the heart, the mouth speaks. If anyone has a mean mouth, well, then that just means they have a mean heart. And you don't have to take my word for it, because those were the words of Jesus. The psalmist said in Psalm 17:3, though you probe my heart and examine me at night, though you test me, you will find nothing. I have resolved that my mouth will not sin. So the psalmist is resolved to watch his mouth. That's where it all begins. Our text says, I will watch my ways. I will keep my tongue from sin. I will put a muzzle on my mouth. We must watch our mouth. We have to watch the way that we speak, the words that we say, the inflection that we put in, the insinuations, all of those things. We have to keep from sinning by what we say. So that's the first thing to pay attention to. Pay attention to your words. Secondly, the psalmist says, I will watch my days. I'll pay attention to the number of days that I have. Verse 4 says, O Lord, my life's end and the number of my days, let me know how fleeting my life is. And down in verse 5, he says, each man's life is but a breath. I think James was the one who said that our life is like a vapor. It's here today and gone tomorrow. We all need to remember that our hope for a better life is not in this life. Oh, we try to stretch this life out as long as we can, but the best part of life is not here. It's on the other side. It's in our next life. We're just down here in a process of preparing for that life. And I wish all people would realize just how fleeting life is. And many people act and think like they're never going to die. And really, they should know better. It is appointed unto man once to die, and after that, the judgment. So that puts this first point in with the second point. Watch what you say. Pay attention to your words, because one day you are going to die, and you are going to stand before God. And you'll have to give an account of every word that you said. Even words in private will come up in that judgment. So this life is just a preparation for the next life, and the next life is forever. And if we don't make it right here and now, it won't be right in the next life. There's only one way to make a person's life right on the earth, and that's to be in Christ. He is the way, the truth, the life. If you don't have Jesus in your life today, you're going to be eternally separated from God. And you need to come to Jesus in simple faith, believing that he died for your sin. If there's one truth I'd like to drive home to people, it's this truth, that life is short, and we'd be better, we better be making preparation for the next life. We need Jesus, and we need to live for him. Paul said in Philippians 1:21, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Paul saying that life on earth meant living for Jesus, living like Jesus. Otherwise, death was gain because he would be with Christ. We live down here for one purpose, and that is to please God, our Savior. We need to continue to do that. People are wasting their lives on all kinds of frivolous junk when they should be focusing on Jesus. Colossians 3 says, set your heart on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things, for you died and your life is now hidden with Christ. Again, in the epistle of James chapter 4, beginning at verse 14, he says, what is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, it is the Lord. If it's the Lord's will, we will live and we will do this or that. I know so many people that have just said, this is what I'm going to do. Their will is not the will of God. The Lord's will needs to be the priority in our lives. And every day of our lives, no matter where we are, we must do all that we do for the glory of Christ. Well, there's one more area I want to share that we need to pay attention to, and that is number 3, I will watch my hope. We really need to pay attention to what we put our hope in. We put our hope in our nation, we're going to be disappointed. We put our hope in our bank account, we're going to be disappointed. Verse 7 of our text says, but now, Lord, what do I look for? My hope is in you. Save me from all my transgressions. Do not make me the scorn of fools. A man approached a Little League baseball game one afternoon, and he asked the boy sitting in the dugout, I said, what's the score? And the little boy said, 18 to nothing. We're behind. The guy said, boy, I'll bet you're discouraged. The little boy said, why should I be discouraged? We haven't even gotten up the bat yet. Well, that's the spirit. But most people don't have that kind of spirit. Most people feel like there is little hope in this world, or little to hope in for this world. We have a poor economy. We have a low morality. But we know that our hope is not to be found in this world. not to be found in anything that this world has to offer. I have to pay attention to what I put my hope in. What if you set your hope on? I hope it's not on things of this world. I hope it's not on your abilities or your achievements. To watch our hope means to walk in hope. And there's only one way to do that. That is to keep your eyes on Jesus. We must continually look up. We must continually walk by faith like the saints of old. You know, when David was standing in front of that giant Goliath, David said to him, "You come at me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you defile." Remember Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Boy, they were tied and bound up, ready to be cast into the fiery furnace. And remember what they said to the king? They said, "King, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God that we serve is able to save us from it. And he will rescue us from your hand, O king." The way they looked at it, they said, everything is in God's hand. That's where our hope is. He can save us from it. Or when we go through it and die, we'll be with him anyway. But they went on. Verse 18, they said, "But even if God does not, we know, we want you to know, O king, that we will not serve your God or worship the image of gold that you have set up." Even Daniel, who was in the lion's den, when the king came to him and beat on the door of that lion's den, David's response is, "My God has sent his angels and shut the mouths of lions. They have not hurt me because I was found innocent in his sight. Nor have I ever done anything wrong before you, O king." Someone said, "Think of what we could do today with what we have if we had what they had." Well, beloved, I tell you what, we have what they have. What did they have? They had faith. They walked by faith. They trusted God more than they trusted themselves. They believed God. Philippians 4:13 says, "I can do all things through him who strengthens me, not through me who gives me strength." We are to trust in the Lord with all of our heart, lean not unto our own understanding. Psalm 46:1 says, "God is our refuge and our strength." Psalm 121 says, "I will lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth." You know, that first verse, he says, where does my help come from? There's a question. He's looking under the hills. That's not where his help comes from. See, back in that day, they would build their temples and they would build their shrines and their altars up in the mountains. They believed that's where the gods lived. But the psalmist says, that's not where my help comes from. My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. And Isaiah 40:31 says, "Those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint." And our text says again, "But now, Lord, what do I look for? My hope is in you." Our hope is in the Lord. We must always look to him and must always point others to him. I want to close with a story. Queen Victoria, when she was just a child, she didn't know that she was in line for the throne of England. That did not even enter into her mind. And her tutors, her instructors, they were trying to prepare her for the future, and they were frustrated because they couldn't motivate her. She didn't take her studies seriously. She didn't do the things that she should do as a young princess. Well, finally, the teachers decided to tell her what was coming for her, that she would one day be the Queen of England. Well, upon hearing this, Victoria quietly said, "Then I'll be good." You see, the realization that she had inherited this high calling gave her a sense of responsibility, and it profoundly affected her conduct from that moment on. Well, beloved, because we're children of the King, Because we are headed to heaven, it should motivate us to be responsible Christians in this world. Let's watch our mouths. Watch the way we talk. We need to watch our days and realize that time is short. Jesus could come back any moment now. And we need to watch our hope to make sure that we have our hope in Jesus and cling to Him always. God is the God of the universe, the creator of all things. And He has a wonderful relationship with us, and we can have it with Him. Let me pray for you, and we will be dismissed. Heavenly Father, I do pray that you'd put a watch over our tongue. Help us to always pay attention to the things that we say, pay attention to the time that we have, and pay attention to what we have put our hope in. Lord, we're so thankful that we have a home in heaven, but until that day, help us to share that blessed assurance that we have with others. And we pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I hope to see you back at church Sunday morning at 9 o'clock for our drive-in service, our congregation gathers together. And we do have a wonderful time. And we would love to have you come, even as a visitor. Come and check it out. It's going to be a good time. So we'll see you then. God bless you.